I do hope you have your Bibles. If you do, we're on a journey. We've been going through a letter written to a small church in Corinth. We call it First Letter of Corinthians. We've made it to the end of the third chapter, but I've got to remind you, this letter was written to this small church that was struggling. They were struggling not only from pressures on the outside, they were struggling because of pressures on the inside. There were a bunch of factions in this church. They were fighting and complaining. Some people were saying, we follow Paul. Others were saying, we follow Apollos. Others were saying, Cephas. And so they were dividing amongst each other. And if we look back to where we were last week, Paul's trying to correct this situation, and he reminds them, we're in this together. We shouldn't be dividing. In fact, I want to take you back to the verses we looked at in verse 16 and 17 just to set the stage for what's going on. Paul has written, do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him, for God's temple is holy and you are that temple. Now, sometimes when we read this verse, there are many people who apply this specifically. And we said, I do believe that the Holy Spirit lives in each one of us. But this passage, the yous are actually plural. These are the all y'alls. Don't you realize that all y'all are the temple of God? Why are you fighting? Why are you complaining? Why are you bickering? Why are you arguing? Why are you dividing amongst yourself? You are God's temple, and God's Spirit dwells in you and among you. And if anyone destroys that temple, he's talking about the church. You're not going to enjoy the consequences of that. And so he's encouraging them, well, to work together and to stand together and to contend together against a common enemy rather than fighting amongst themselves. And so he's encouraging them, you are God's temple. The church is not supposed to be this collection of competing or fighting or bickering or even individual, independent people. We are the body of Christ. And so that's where we've been. And as we go into our passage is actually a summary, not only of that, but it's a summary all the way back to chapter 1, verse 10. And so we need to remind ourselves of that as well. Here's what we're talking about. He says, I appeal to you, brothers, in the name of our Lord Jesus, that all of you agree, that there be no division among you, but you be united in the same mind and in the same judgment. We are God's temple. We are the body of Christ. And he's urging this church to get along, to strive together on purpose, to fight a common enemy. And so that's where we've been, and this really serves as a summary statement. The problem in the church there was division and disunity. And he's going to give the solution. We really have to think properly about who we are and what we're supposed to be like, and as we get to our passage today, he gives us the solution. So again, I hope you have your Bibles. We're starting in verse 18. Let no one deceive himself. If anyone among you thinks that he's wise in this age, let him become a fool, that he may become wise. For the wisdom of this world is folly with God, for it's written, he catches the wise in their craftiness. And again, the Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, they are futile. So let no one boast in men, for all things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas or the world or life or death or the present or the future, all are yours, and you are Christ's, and Christ is God's. Our passage, I want you to notice, actually has three commands and then kind of a final summary statement. I'd ask you to maybe even underline these commands. The ESV translates each of these, let us. But they're actually not subjunctives. These are commands in Greek, and so they're much stronger than that. Do not, or in some cases, do these things. And I'd underline, because he gives three commands and then makes a statement based on these three commands, and that's going to serve as our outline today. Notice the commands. Let no one deceive himself, or again, let him become a fool, or let no one boast in men. And he's going to build on those arguments and really give us four principles. If we'd follow these things, the church wouldn't be fighting. In fact, the church could work together and strive in harmony. By these four things, we could banish divisiveness. To achieve unity in the church, we've got to have a proper view of ourselves, a proper view of others, a proper view of our possessions, and most importantly, a proper view of who we are in Christ. And that's where he's going to take us. So let me just show you those each one by one. He's going to start by saying, let each of you, if you want to get along, if you want to banish divisiveness, you need to have a proper view of yourself, or let us have, let no one deceive himself, a proper view of ourselves. Now, you know I love words. And this word deceive, let no one deceive himself. Well, it is a word that can be translated deceive, or it could actually even be translated cheat. Usually when we think of deceiving or cheating, we think about doing that to somebody else. We're going to deceive somebody else, or we're going to cheat somebody else. He qualifies this. It says it right in our passage. Let no one deceive himself. And even, maybe a little stronger, don't cheat yourself. Well, how are they doing that? By having a too big of a view of yourself. The problem is exactly that. They had an inflated view of themselves. Look how great we are. They had an inflated view even of their leaders. Look, we follow Paul. We follow Apollos, and that's the one you should follow, or Cephas. It was all about themselves, or all about their own party, about their apostles, about their people, the ones that sided with them, and their position. They were superior. They were a cut above the rest. These people were really full of themselves. Now, have you ever known anybody like that? Now, no elbows, right? But have you known people that are full of themselves? They've got too high of a view of themselves or their position or their opinion. That's what was going on in the church. And they were fighting and bickering because they thought they were right and other people were wrong. And Paul says, hold a second, don't you remember that we all are the body of Christ? We are the church. Paul responds, you're dividing over things that really are pretty unimportant, and much of your division would be eliminated if you weren't so impressed with yourself. I remember from yesteryear, maybe you can remember too. Do you remember Mac Davis? Oh Lord, it's hard to be humble, right? You remember this? When you're perfect in every way. Well, that's kind of what these people are doing. We're right and you're wrong. And again, I'm going to suggest to you that we know people like that. They've got way too big a view of themselves. Now, it was true not only in the first century, it's true in the 21st century. There are many people that spiritually, at least, many Christians walk around with their nose in the air. We're better than you are. Have you known that to be true? And we need to realize, let's have a proper view of ourselves. Without Christ, actually, we're nothing. And we need to realize, without Christ, we're all in the same boat. We're sinners. And we have nothing to boast about. We need to boast in Christ Jesus and who he is and what he has done for us. And so there's no room for an attitude of arrogance or pride. I'm superior. We should have the opposite attitude. I am nothing without Christ Jesus. What's interesting is the language he uses. Not only don't deceive yourself, don't cheat yourself, but we actually find the word sophomore kind of in our passage. If we look at verse 18, notice he says, if anyone thinks that he's wise, that's the word sophos, wisdom, let him become a fool. That's the word moros, or even moron. We get sophomore, a wise fool. Now, think about that for a second. Now, the truth of the matter is, I want to back up a step, a freshman. It's amazing, especially in Bible college. I still teach part-time at Bible college, and it's amazing after a student has gone through his freshman year at Bible college, a lot of times they want to go home and they want to change their church. Hey, we know how things are supposed to be done. Here's how you do it properly. And so they've got this great attitude of themselves, right? That's a freshman. At least by the time they're a sophomore, they understand, well, they're just a wise fool. They start to begin to realize how much they don't know. And so a freshman thinks they know everything, and a sophomore is a wise fool. And part of wisdom is actually knowing how much you don't know. And so that's a great place to get to. But Paul is not saying you shouldn't have wisdom. Paul's not telling the Corinthians to neglect the pursuit of wisdom, but he is saying if your worldly wisdom holds you back from God, it's actually not wisdom at all. Being wise is a good thing, but I bet you even know people that are really, really into they've got a strong intellect. They're really wise, but at the same time, they're fools. And Paul's actually saying that. You could be wise in business, or you could be wise in math or science or philosophy, but if you do not know the most important truth, you're still a fool. And he actually says there are a bunch of people who are wise fools, but as Christians, we need to reverse that around and say, okay, we're going to have wisdom in God. True knowledge includes knowledge of God, and much of our knowledge about God is only available because God himself has revealed it to us. Even the wisest people can stop and theorize about who God is and what he's like. But we don't have to stop and theorize. God has actually revealed himself to us. You can guess and theorize all you want, or you can actually go and find out what God truly is and what he's like. And I want to make a strong statement, first of all, just to see if you're awake, but I'd maybe like you to react a little bit with this. Just think about this statement. So here's my strong statement I want to make to you. Even as Christians, we do not have the right to our own opinion about things that God has directly revealed to us. See, God has told us about himself. God has actually told us what right and wrong is. God has defined things for us. He's given us the right way of living. And there are people that in their own wisdom, they want to stop and say, no, that's not how it should be. I've got to stop and say, we have no right, especially as Christians, if we believe God's in charge, if we believe God has designed us and created us, we do not have a right to say, okay, I know God said that, but I disagree. I want to tell you that's happening today. And those people who want to redefine what God has said, even though they may think they're wise, I'm going to stop and tell you, they're fools. Because God's in charge, and let God define things, because he has every right to. Do you understand what I'm talking about? There are people who are wise, but the truth of the matter is, because they do not know God, they are fools. True knowledge includes knowledge of God. In fact, what God has revealed to us, the gospel, and what the church is supposed to be like, and Christian living, and morals, and codes of conduct, he has given us those, well, those definitions. And if we're truly wise, we'll follow those. We cannot bend. You see, we live in a society that thinks it's wise, and we live in a world that wants to follow standards of the age, and God says, are you ready? What a bunch of fools. That's what he says. Paul has said this earlier. Paul said, the message of the cross is foolishness to men. Now he changes that around, and he actually says the flip side. The wisdom of this world is foolishness to God. And I want to stop and say, we've got to create an atmosphere where God's word is honored and submitted to. Do you understand that? We trust God and his word on things. We've got to create this environment where God's word is honored and submitted to, which leads me to a second strong statement. My second strong statement is this. When the truth of Scripture is not the source of our authority, man's opinion becomes the authority, and we become fools. And that's exactly what's happening today. We're allowing the world to define things rather than God. And all of a sudden, if this is no longer our authority, what is the authority? Well, it's man's opinion. And when that happens, we have become fools. And it's happening today. Paul's challenge in this church, why are you arguing? Why are you fighting, complaining about things that don't matter? You're actually a bunch of fools if you're not following God's word. And to illustrate that point, Paul actually pulls out two Old Testament scriptures to make his case, to prove his point. And so in verse 19, he actually says, he catches the wise in their craftiness. That's a quote from the book of Job. He catches the wise in their craftiness. Now, here's what's happening. You remember all the calamities of Job. Job has these friends. He has one friend, Eliphaz, who comes and is trying to convince Job of all his wrongdoing. Now, the truth of the matter is, much of what Eliphaz says, it's actually wrong. But he points this out. God catches the wise in their wisdom. Now, later on, Job's going to come to his senses, and I love what happens, because they would have known this story. Later on, Job is going to realize, I've been trying to tell God what to do, and I can't tell God to do what to do any longer. And so when we get clear down later in chapter 42, Job repents and says, I have uttered what I did not understand, things too wonderful for me, which I did not know. The point is this. Are you going to tell God how he should be doing things? Or are you going to allow God to tell us how we're doing things? And the point is, God catches the wise in their craftiness, and by the way, they're fools. That's his first point. They knew that story well. Then he goes and he quotes another scripture. Really, it has the same point, but as we get deeper, verse 20, he actually quotes the Psalm, Psalms 94. Here's the quote, the Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, that they are futile. If you go through that Psalm, and again, they would have known their Old Testament scriptures, the Lord knows, and the psalm mocks those who think they're wise when they're really fools. The psalm mocks those who think they're actually triumphant when they're actually going to lose. It mocks those who think they're safe when they rebel against God, and the psalm ends by saying, those who mock God, they're the fools. You see, mock God now, but God's going to mock you later. That's really how the psalm ends. And it gives us a warning. Those people who rely only on human wisdom, they will be brought under God's judgment. And when push comes to shove, you thought you were wise, you forgot God, you are a fool. Only that perspective, which realizes your own limitations and the understanding that we've got to seek God, only then will we be on the right track. And so don't think too much of yourself. You're just deceiving yourself. You think you're wise? Well, not so much without God. He gives us a second requirement if we really want to get along. First of all, don't think too highly of yourself and actually follow God's plan. The second bit of wisdom is this. You've got to have a proper view of other people. Now, this church was fighting. We follow Paul. We follow Apollos. We follow Cephas. And he says, let no one boast in men. They were dividing over, here's our apostle. Here's our group of people arguing Paul or Apollos or Cephas. And Paul stops and says, hold a second, they're just men. Understand, they're partners. He actually is not devaluing the work of Apollos or Cephas. He's actually going to lift them up and say, we're on the same team. And they should be, if they're worthy of following, they should be followed, but don't make them out to be more than they are. There were people who were attracted to certain personalities or styles of preaching or their methods or even their just the way they did things rather than their message. And he's saying, don't have special loyalty to them. They're just men. Actually, they're messengers. They're going to tell you about Christ, but what you need to do is be attracted to Christ, not men. They're actually on the same team. They shouldn't be elevated, but also don't misunderstand this passage. He's not saying don't listen to teachers. He's going to go on through 1 Corinthians and actually say if they're preaching the message of the cross, you need to listen to them. In fact, you need to listen carefully. If they're preaching Christ, you shouldn't be dividing over them. They should be leading together because they too are servants and stewards. And so he's not saying don't listen to them. That's really important. I've seen people preach this passage and say, well, we shouldn't be concerned about what leaders are doing. Paul's going to actually argue the opposite. They should be listened to if they are following Christ. Now let me show that to you before we go on. The very next verse after our passage is chapter 4, verse 1. He says, this is how one should regard us. As servants of Christ, as stewards, they're holding the mysteries of God. Moreover, it's a requirement of stewards they be found faithful. So he's not diminishing Apollos. He's on my team. Or Cephas, he's preaching the gospel, but the point is not about them. It's about what they preach. And if they're preaching Christ crucified, you should listen to them. Let me take you a little bit deeper as we get into chapter 4, verse 16. We read this. I urge you then, be imitators of me. Or later still, be imitators of me as I am of Christ. You need to follow leaders who are following Christ well. But you shouldn't hold up your leader as the one that's important. You should hold up Jesus Christ as the one who's important. Do you understand the difference there? They're fighting about men when those men are supposed to be on the same team. It's not that you shouldn't listen to them. You should listen because they're all doing the same thing and trying to accomplish the same purpose. And if they're following Christ well, you follow them. I love how John MacArthur actually puts this passage straight. He says, a preacher who carefully preaches God's word and lives a life consistent with his preaching deserves to be respected and followed. On the other hand, one who is careless in preaching and living does not deserve to be respected or followed. Follow those who lead well. I want to say I am so thankful to be part of a church where we've got godly ministers, men and women of integrity. It's not a show. They are following Christ well. What a privilege to serve with them. I am so thankful to be a part of a church where our elders are godly men of integrity who what they want to do is build up God's kingdom. And they deserve to be followed because they lead well. I am so thankful even for our volunteers in our church. People that take on ministries, and they do it for the name of Jesus Christ. What a place to be when men and women of integrity are following Jesus Christ and trying to lead others along with him. Isn't it great to be a part of a church like that? Yes? Follow those who lead well. And so, but have a proper view. It's not about them. The writer of Hebrews actually carries this along also in chapter 13. He says, remember your leaders, those who spoke to you the word of God, consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. It is good to follow others who are following Christ well. Let me turn that around. It's also those of you who are following Christ well, it's great for you to be leading others along and say, look, here's how it should be done. We need mentors in our life. We also need people to mentor others. And that's what Paul is saying here. Have a proper view. They're servants, they're stewards, and those who serve well and lead well, follow them, but don't elevate them. We should actually rejoice and profit from faithful leaders, but we should not divide over those faithful leaders. And that's his point. You shouldn't divide over whether it's Paul or Apollos or Cephas or Luther or Zwingli. We shouldn't divide over men. We shouldn't divide over Calvin. Okay, I just want to clarify this for Scott. Calvin and Hobbes, it's not the same. Okay, great theologians, maybe, but that's not what I'm talking about. You understand, we shouldn't divide over men. We shouldn't be saying, well, I'm a follower of such and such. What we need to say is, we're followers of Christ. And that's his point. Church, why are you fighting and saying, well, I follow Paul or I follow Apollos? They're just men, they're stewards, they're servants. What we should do is say we are following Christ Jesus, have a proper view of ourselves and others. He goes on, gives us a third requirement for overcoming church division. Interesting phrase. Don't you realize you have all things? We read a proper view of possessions. For all things are yours. What's that mean? Whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas or the world or life or death or the present or the future, all are yours. He is telling us to have a proper view of things. And here's his point. The church actually does not belong to Paul. The church doesn't belong to Apollos or even to Cephas. All things actually are yours. You are the body of Christ. And we're going to get this later where we realize whether you're a head or a foot or an eye, we all have a purpose. And we are the church, and it belongs to all of us. It doesn't belong to one man. It doesn't belong to Paul or Apollos. It belongs to everyone. The church is not Paul's. He is a servant. Apollos is a steward. All things belong to all y'all. And this is great news, actually. Because all the spiritual blessings that are available in Christ are yours. They don't come through me. They don't come through your preacher. They don't come through an apostle. They come through Christ Jesus. All things are yours. All the spiritual things, all the spiritual blessings of Christ are yours in Christ Jesus. They're available to all Christians. Just think about this. Spiritual life, it's available through Christ Jesus. Salvation is ours through Christ Jesus. Forgiveness is ours through Christ Jesus. All those spiritual blessings, and he lists some of those. Things present, they're ours in Christ Jesus. Things to come are ours in Christ Jesus. Isn't this great news? Yes, no? Amen. It's not because of Paul or Apollos, it's because of Jesus Christ. All things are yours, whether present or things to come. Even death is ours. And I stop and say, oh, hold it a second. Even death is ours? That doesn't sound like good news. What does Paul mean by that? Well, I want to contrast for you what Paul's talking about. Worldly wisdom and spiritual wisdom. Death, in the world's eyes, what is that? In the world's eyes, death is a tragedy. In a world, the world's eyes, death is the end. The world's view, whoever dies with the most toys wins. Then you really lived. Well, that's a tragedy. Death is to be avoided at all cost. But Paul actually is contrasting this and say, hold a second, even death is ours. As Christians, we can have peace in dying. As Christians, we realize it's not the end, it's just the beginning. As Christians, we realize it's an avenue which leads us to spiritual eternal life. We realize as Christians, death has been swallowed up in victory by Jesus Christ, and that's great news. Even death in Christ Jesus, it's ours. It can be celebrated. Death releases us to immortality. Paul's going to say elsewhere, death is gain. Let me just show you a couple of scriptures. I love these. Here's 1 Corinthians. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we'll be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, the last trumpet, the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. Then shall come to pass the saying that's written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where's your victory? O death, where's your sting? The sting of death is sin. The power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Isn't this great news? Why are we fighting and bickering over things that don't matter? Don't you realize all you need is available in Christ Jesus? It's already been provided for you. Those things for now, those things in the future. Even death itself has been delivered to you through Christ Jesus. And what we need to do as a church is realize the great blessings we have in Christ. It's not about Paul. It's not about Apollos. It's not about fighting and bickering and demanding our own way. It's a realization that everything we have actually belongs to God. And because of Jesus, we have those things now and in the future. And Paul's saying, shouldn't we be celebrating those things rather than fighting each other? Or I love what he says in Romans. We read Romans chapter 8. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? No! In all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, or depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that's in Christ Jesus our Lord. Let's have a proper view of ourselves. We're nothing without Christ. Let's have a proper view of our leaders. We follow them as they follow Christ Jesus. But it's about Christ, it's not about them. And let's have a proper view of really everything around us. Everything is already ours. It's not the world's. It's ours in Christ Jesus. And we need to remember that. And then he gives us one more key for becoming the church that God wants us to be. One more requirement for overcoming church division. And it's a proper view of our position. A proper view of our position. We are in Christ Jesus. Now, we've talked about this already. The church was fighting. There were factions following their specific leaders. There are people saying, well, we follow Apollos, and these are the people that are in our group, and these people belong to us. And Paul says, hold it a second. No, brothers. You belong to Christ. You don't belong to Paul or Apollos. You belong to Christ Jesus. You belong to Jesus because He is the source of unity. He's the source of healing. He's the source of forgiveness. We belong to Christ Jesus, and Christ belongs to God. And some interesting language here, and this is actually the most important part of our section. Some language that might be confusing. You're Christ, and Christ is God's. What is this? I've got to stop and say it's not a diminishing return. Okay, there's God, and then there's Jesus, and then there's us. It's not a pecking order of diminishing returns. It's actually in Greek, just the opposite. I've got to give you a Greek lesson. Is that okay? Some of you can fall asleep. I'll wake up in a moment. This is going to become very important, by the way, as we get deeper into chapter 8 and into chapter 11 and chapter 15. As Paul writes here, he uses the genitive of source. How's that? It's impressive, isn't it? The genitive of source. What it means is, because of the source, you have everything that the source has. A genitive, this is belonging to us, of source. Let me ask you a question. I bet you get the answer. What belongs to God? Everything belongs to God, right? Are we agreed about that? Everything belongs to God. Well, guess what? Jesus has everything that God has. Because God has it, Jesus has that. And by the way, because of Jesus Christ, you have access to that. Let me say it a different way. Because of what Jesus Christ has done for us, we have access to the glory of God. And because Jesus has all things, because God has all things, all of a sudden now we have access to all things. Because it's belonging to Jesus, because it's belonging to God, we now have access to everything. I want to tell you, this is great news. We need to realize that all you have, that all you need, God will provide for you through Christ Jesus. And because of Him, well, we've got hope. And because of Him, we've got help. And because of Him, we won't be lacking anything that we need. We have got all that's necessary in Christ Jesus our Lord because, well, He's reconciled us with God. And that's what He's saying. Don't you realize you guys are fighting and arguing about who's the greatest? Hold on a second. Don't you realize you don't need to fight and bicker because everything is already yours through Christ Jesus? You're complaining and thinking you're superior. Hold on a second. It's about Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ has already reconciled us to God. And God is providing us all things. Why are you arguing? Don't you realize what's going on here? Everything that God has is available in Christ Jesus, and because of Christ Jesus, everything has now been provided to us. It's available to us, and we can approach God through Jesus Christ. Now, think about this. We can approach God through Jesus Christ. You don't need a priest. You don't need a minister. You don't need an apostle. You've got direct access because you have Jesus Christ. And so why are you arguing and complaining? Everything that God has been provided through Jesus Christ, and now because of Jesus Christ, we have access to this. Isn't this great news? Yes? No? That's Paul's point. You're the body of Christ. You are the body of Christ. Why are you fighting and arguing and bickering? Why are you taking up sides and dividing as if, well, a Paul or Apollos can bring you something that you don't already have? You've got it already in Christ Jesus. Actually, Paul is nothing. Well, he's a servant. Apollos is nothing. He's a steward. But follow them as they follow Christ because everything we have is available in Christ Jesus. And he's trying to bring this church together and saying, look, let's banish divisiveness and let's start becoming what we've already been pronounced to be. We are the body of Christ. And what would happen? What would happen if the church came together? And rather than fighting each other, or complaining or bickering or arguing, what would happen if the church came together and started fighting a common enemy? What if all the Bible-believing churches would actually stand up and say, look, we're not going to follow worldly wisdom anymore. We're going to follow the wisdom of God because we realize that the best the world has to offer is foolishness compared to God. And we're going to follow God because He is the one that knows what we're supposed to be like. He knows how we're supposed to live. He's given us the instruction manual. What if Bible-believing Christians would stand up together and say, look, we're going to stand strong. We will not bow. We won't bend. We're going to take the gospel message of Jesus Christ forward. The message is this. It's the message of the cross. I know it's foolishness to the world. But Jesus Christ and Christ crucified is what we're going to preach. And we realize there's hope nowhere else. There's help nowhere else. It's only in Jesus Christ. And what if we started... Well, moving forward together rather than standing still and fought each other. Do you understand what I'm talking about? Paul is saying, you are the body of Christ. You already have everything you need in Christ Jesus. I love how Paul addresses this elsewhere in Romans chapter 14. It's all about Jesus. For if we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. It's not about Paul. It's not about Apollos. It's not about Cephas. It's not about Luther. It's not about Calvin. It's about Jesus. And everything we have and everything we are, it's His. And so we're going to give Him the glory. Would you pray with me? Father, I want to come before you and help us realize that what we need to do is have a proper view of ourselves and a proper view of others and a proper view of our possessions and realize everything we have, it's yours anyway. And so, Father, help us understand this and help us submit to Jesus Christ because we realize it's only possible through Him. And so, Father, help us lift up Jesus Christ. Help us proclaim Jesus Christ. Help us live for Jesus Christ. And that's our prayer. We pray this in the blessed name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus. Amen.